SSRI side effects. And the goal of this video is to present the side effects in a practical and useful way. I don't want to just clobber you over the head with a list of the side effects, but actually give you context and meaning to what the side effects are and how you'd expect them to affect the patient's life. A common way these side effects are presented is just a giant list. For example, WebMD has
insomnia, headaches, rash, blurred vision, drowsiness, dry mouth, agitation, nervousness, feeling dizzy, pain in joints or muscles, upset stomach, nausea, diarrhea, reduced sexual desire, and problems with erection.
Some lists also include percentages, but I still feel like that's just marginally more helpful. When I was trying to find papers that went over how to discuss these side effects with patients, I found this table, which I found pretty funny just how vague this is.
Yeah.
So my goal of this video is to give context in life to what to expect when taking SSRIs. And one statistic I actually find helpful is that 34% of people have little to no side effects, 40% have mild to moderate side effects, and 26% have severe side effects. So in my opinion, the numbers are close enough to say that a third of people have little to no side effects, so it doesn't affect them. A third of people have mild to moderate side effects that are bearable, and a third of people have severe side effects and it's not worth it. But let's jump into what the side effects actually are. I like to split the side effects into different categories. So the first three categories are time-dependent categories. So the first category is early and self-limiting. So the early side effects are ones that occur basically as soon as you start the drug. And self-limiting just means that these side effects tend to get better with time as your body adjusts to being on the medication. Then there are side effects that are early and tend to persist throughout treatment, so you don't expect them to get better. Then there are side effects that occur later down the line in treatment. And then the fourth category is separate from time, is more just the rare side effects or the side effects that are population specific. So in my opinion, when you present the side effects to patients, you should definitely be presenting the side effects from the first three categories. And then the side effects from the fourth category, you kind of tailor to the patient. So now I'll go over which side effect is in which each category, and then afterwards I'll go one by one to give context to what these side effects look like. So for the side effects in the early and self-limiting category, I tell the patient that if they experience these, they can expect them to probably get better over time, so that if they're bearable, to try to hang with it. So the side effects here include GI side effects like nausea and diarrhea, feeling drowsy or sleepy, then having some insomnia. And then even though these medications treat anxiety, typically early on patients can experience anxiety or jitteriness or restlessness. And then the last two are dry mouth and headache. Then the side effects that occur early and tend to persist throughout treatment are the sexual side effects and emotional blunting. And the side effects that occur later in treatment are weight gain and then, of course, the withdrawal if you come off the medications. In my opinion, the side effects that every clinician should talk about more when presenting the side effects to patients are the sexual side effects, the emotional blunting, and the weight gain. And the reason why I say that these are the ones that should be talked about is because they're the ones that tend to persist, and they're the ones that the patients tend to worry the most about. I also think it's important to emphasize that there's major variance in terms of the side effects that each individual patient experiences, and there's major variance in terms of the severity of the side effects. And then the side effects that should be talked about that are rare or population specific, which include suicidal thoughts in patients 24 and younger, QTC prolongation in cardiac patients, drug-drug interactions in patients taking other medications, bipolar switching in patients with a family history of psychosis or bipolar, the increased bleeding risk, especially in patients taking other anticoagulants, hyponatremia, especially in elderly patients, and then the rare, scary side effect, which is serotonin syndrome. Now, before I go one by one into the details of the side effects, I do want to talk about the medications and when it's appropriate to prescribe them or not prescribe them. So first, I want to describe a simplistic paradigm of how to prescribe medications that I think is inappropriate, and then I want to talk about the paradigm that I think that people should be moving towards. So the bad unnuance paradigm is when people think that either you have depression or you don't, and if you have depression, you should be on medications like SSRIs, and if you don't have depression, then you shouldn't be on medications like SSRIs. And I don't have time in this video to go over why this way of thinking is flawed, but I do want to review a more nuanced view of mental health and prescribing. So the better paradigm to operate under is weighing whether the benefits of taking a medication outweighs the negatives of taking a medication. And also, you should move away from thinking that a medication has a positive way of working and then negative side effects attached to it, and recognize that a drug just does what it does, and whether or not it's good or bad for a person really depends on that particular person. So let me demonstrate this with a pretty silly extreme example. Imagine you're trying to treat a priest and a porn star. I mean, like, two different people, not a priest porn star. Let's consider the quote-unquote side effects of emotional blunting and sexual problems. So for a priest, you know, not to get political here or anything, but having a decreased libido might actually be a positive thing for a priest. Whereas emotional blunting might be a negative thing because he might lose access to emotions that help him communicate the word of God. But then when we consider someone like a porn star, the quote unquote sexual side effects, which is decreased libido and difficulty orgasming, might be completely detrimental to his career, which naturally would affect his mental health. But then the emotional blunting might be a positive thing because the, you know, porn star isn't catching feelings on the set. So the point I hope you take away from this silly example is that you really can't consider whether a medication is a good or a bad thing without considering the individual that you're prescribing the medication. All right, so in the next video, I'll be going one by one into the side effects to give them context and meaning so that they're not just this completely meaningless list to you.